How many of you are students right now? At what level? Masters? Okay. Undergraduate. From where? Mysore University. Good. PhD level. And how many of you are teachers, professors? Okay. So we have got a good mix of both the species. Unfortunately, the decent treatment of dynamical systems is not included in many university curriculum. So, I possibly can anticipate that some of the things that I'll be teaching would be new to you. And also, it is quite possible that some of you who have done something related in the first year or in the second year, I can confidently assume that you have forgotten. So, I may possibly have to start from ground zero, but Shomik has covered to some extent, and I was told that he has covered the one dimensional differential equation and the bifurcations resulting from that. So, I will sort of skip that and I will go to the second two dimensional stuff right in the beginning. So, here we are talking about dynamical systems, and anything that changes is a dynamical system. So, it is not only anything that moves is a dynamical system, anything that changes is a dynamical system. And obviously, there is nothing in this world that is not changing, and therefore, there is nothing that is not a subject of our study. Everything is subject of our study. So, when a physicist looks at a dynamical system, it could be a pendulum, it could be the motion of the stars and planets, it could be a reaction going on where the concentration of various reagents are changing with time, it could be a man aging through through time. So, everything is changing, or maybe the number of mosquitoes changing with time. So, all these are dynamical systems. Now, when we physicists have to represent such a thing, try to understand such a thing, then we have to represent it somehow. And two very elementary ways of representation of dynamical systems are A, as differential equations, and B, as maps. Let us start with some examples. And some of my favorite examples comes from ecology. So, let me start with some examples from ecology, and let me illustrate how differential equations are formed often in a very common sense way, but that leads to quite a few very important results. What is it? So, we can consider ecology as a dynamical system where the number of individuals of a particular species fluctuate. So, that is a dynamical variable then. So, we have to define what is a dynamical variable, and a dynamical variable in this case is the number of individuals in a species, and that changes with time. So, if that changes with time, then you get since the number of species is a discrete number, you cannot have 2.5492 number of individuals, right? So, it is a discrete number, and that also changes discretely. So, that can be conveniently represented as a equation like this. In the nth generation, if the number is x n, then that gives the number of individuals in the n plus 1th generation. So, the number of individuals in n plus 1th generation is a function of the number of individuals in a nth generation. If an equation like this will be called a map. Okay. And much of the dynamical systems are understood in terms of maps. The pointer is not there, no? Or yeah, the battery is coming. Okay, okay. We are being powered. Wait a minute. And in continuous time, the representation would be something like this, differential equations, and I am representing a second order differential equation. So, the x variable changes, how does it change? Dx dt is a function of both x and y, Similarly, y variable changes, how does it change? Dy dt is another function of x and y. So, we have to effectively understand the character of the dynamical system. The problem placement is the following. The character of the dynamical system, how does it behave and all that, will be represented by the functional forms f in case of the map, or f 1 f 2 in case of the differential equation. So, let us consider how such a map or a differential equation is formed, and I said that I will be taking an example from ecology. So, let us consider the situation where there are fish in a pond, and presently for the sake of simplicity consider just one species of fish in a pond. Therefore, the number of fish in the pond is represented by x n, the number of fish in the nth generation, and let us normalize it within 0 and 1. That means, the maximum possible population is whatever it is, divide the actual number by that, so that you get something that is normalized between 0 and 1. So, that is the x n, and then how do we try to represent it? Arguing common sense, if the situation in the pond is conducive to the reproduction of that particular species of fish, then they will increase. If it is not conducive, it is decrease, it will decrease. And in any case, in the next generation, you can assume the population to be proportional to that in the earlier generation. So, that mu is the proportionality constant, and it goes follows from common sense that if mu is large, it effectively represents a very conducive environment. If mu is small, it represents a non-conducive environment. But then, this is a good model if the population is small, but you can easily see that if you really follow this model, it will go on increasing, 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 go to infinity, which is not possible in a pond. So, something needs to be done to that. And when it is large, the overpopulation will lead to scarcity of food, and therefore, it will slow down its growth. That needs to be built into the model, and that can be done by plugging in this 1 minus x n. So, you have this as a reasonably plausible model. So, 1 minus x n will have the property that if x n goes close to 1, this 1 minus x n will be close to 0, and therefore, the whole thing will go down. This model, you keep in mind, it is called the logistic map, and we will have a lot to do with this logistic map when we deal with maps. So, you see, there was no great rocket science involved in it. It was just a common sense way of formulating some kind of a model. Let us consider a continuous time dynamical system when the number of individuals in a species are reasonably large, then that can be reasonably well approximated by a continuous variable. Suppose there are two species, now we are going to 2D. There are two species in a forest, tiger and deer. If the tigers eat the deer, and deer survive by avoiding predators, and they eat grass, of course, there has to be grass there. So, these are the two populations. What does x represent? The number of the prey species, y represents the number of the predator species. So, now we argue. Suppose the forest were devoid of any tigers, only deer. What will happen? The number will increase. And the number, the increase of number is effectively represented by the rate of increase will be proportional to the number that we have right now. So, x dot is equal to ax, which will be a reasonably good first approximation. And then when the predators are present, they will eat the deer. So, there will be another term plugged in, which will be, you know, negative term, and it follows from common sense that the more the tiger meets the deer, the more will be the probability of the reduction of the number of the deer. Okay, so how would a physicist represent such a thing? By simple product. The number of deer times number of tiger is sort of representative of the number of times they will meet each other, and therefore there will be a negative term BXY. So these two together will represent the behavior of the system. Now let's come to the evolution of the predator species. Follow the same logic. Suppose there is no prey, what will happen? They will die. So therefore, it will have a negative decay. So the minus CXY, C is the proportionality constant, which will be negative, so it will be exponential decay. But when prey are present, the number will increase proportional to the number of times the predators meet the prey, and therefore there would be another positive terms proportional to the product. So you see the actual model of the system becomes like this. Okay. Write it down on your copy and we will come back to it in a tutorial class. We will work out the behavior of, as a physicist, what would you predict the behavior of the system to be? We will come back to this. Is it understood? AX is a proportional increase, BXY is the decrease term of the prey population, Y dot is the increase which is proportional to the minus CXY and plus BXY. Okay, so we are setting the stage. We will have to try to understand the behavior of these dynamical systems in terms of these functions. This is the function of F1 XY. This one is the F2 of XY. Will it work? No, it doesn't work. So if you have a set of differential equations that look like this, what is the specialty? Here X dot is equal to function of XYZ, Y dot is equal to function of XYZ, so on and so forth, but in the right hand side there is no time. There is no explicit time dependence. So whenever that happens, we call that set of equations as a autonomous set of equations. For example, this is the Lorentz model. It was developed in trying to represent the weather system, the atmospheric convection, but it is a autonomous dynamical system. And if you have some kind of a t dependent term in the right hand side, that will be a non-autonomous dynamical system. So these terms, when I use, this will mean this is actually a representation of a periodically forced pendulum. So this is just introduction of the terms that I will use later. Can I change? Well, we represent the behavior of the dynamical systems in the phase space, where we plot in the x, y, z coordinates the variables. Therefore, in the x coordinate, it will be the first variable x1, in the y coordinate, it will be the second variable x2, and therefore, the dynamical status of the system will be uniquely represented by just a point in the phase space. Okay? A point. And then what does the differential equations do? That tells how does the point move. Okay? And then if you have a point here, then the differential equations are saying that x dot is a function of x and y. Plug in this function's position and you will find something, x dot is a number. Similarly, y dot will come to a number. X dot says how does it move in the next instant in the x direction. Y dot says how does it move in the y direction in the next instant, and therefore putting them together you get a vector, right? Which means that at every point of this space, there is a vector sitting. And as you solve the differential equations, you get a trajectory like this. So, our trajectory in this case will be a something like a motion in the phase space. Now, what does the differential equation do actually is to define an arrow at every point in the phase space. Because of the reason that say your point is here, x, y values are here, and that the differential equation will immediately define an arrow in that direction, and the evolution actually happens in that direction. So, effectively what happens as you solve a differential equation is that it just follows the arrow around in the phase space. Therefore, the character of the dynamical system, what it can do, not just what it will do, what it can do is also embedded in the character of those arrows, the vector field. So, the understanding the character of the vector field is a very important affair that we take up. For example, this is the vector field for this set of differential equations. Good. So, in understanding the character of the vector fields like this, for example, you can see that there is some speciality of this point. At that point, the vector has zero size. So, that is a fixed point, equilibrium point. So, the equilibrium points are obtained simply by putting x dot is equal to the function of x is equal to 0, which means that in the next instant it will not move. X dot is 0. Dx dt is 0 means it does not change. So, these are the equilibrium points, and the next thing that we do is to find out the behavior around the equilibrium point. This is extremely important for the purpose of understanding the behavior of dynamical system, to understand the behavior around the equilibrium points. For example, you had the pendulum, right? The pendulum is nice thing, but how do we get the pendulum into a simple harmonic motion? By locally linearizing around this point. So, this is what actually we do, but for all the systems that we handle, not only for the pendulum. And in order to do that, we do that by writing a linear set of differential equations, where this matrix is just the Jacobian matrix. So, we locally linearize the vector field around the equilibrium point, try to understand the behavior around each equilibrium point, and then try to put things together. That is the way we normally proceed. So, let us do this, rather you do this for this system. Write it down on your copy and locally linearize what we just said. Let us do it. So, you have x double dot minus 1 minus x square x dot plus x equal to 0. We need to shape it in the form of two first order differential equations. In order to do that, we say y is equal to x dot, or let us write it ulta, x dot is equal to y, then y dot is equal to, goes to this side, 1 minus x square, x dot is equal to y minus x, right? Then the Jacobian matrix will be the first term is derivative of f 1 with respect to x, which is obviously 0. So, this is our f 1 x y, and this is our f 2 of x y. So, in the Jacobian matrix, f 1 of x y is just y. So, it will be 0. f 2 f 1 of dy of f1 is 1. ddx of f2 is minus 2xy minus 1. Huh? And what about this term in terms of y? That will do. Right? For this set of differential equations, what is the equilibrium point? The equilibrium point is by putting x dot is equal to 0, y dot is equal to 0. The moment you put x dot equal to 0, y is equal to 0. And the moment you put y dot equal to 0 and y is equal to 0 already, x equal to 0. So, 0, 0 is the equilibrium point. Okay? So, you are trying to figure out the behavior around this equilibrium point, and therefore, you have to plug in these values here. If you plug in these values, what do you get? You get 0, 1, this is minus 1, so this matrix will tell what will be the behavior around this equilibrium point. And the fact that it is going around this equilibrium point will be obtained from this matrix simply, and I will come to that. This is what we have already done. Let's go ahead. For example, this one is I just worked out. Okay. Yeah, Jacobian matrix tells us what is the behavior around that equilibrium point. We have. Yeah. It is a large canvas. And in different parts of the canvas, the behavior could be different. But then we are saying that here is an equilibrium point. If I take a small box around that, what is the behavior if the initial condition is inside the box? How will it behave? And that information is contained in that matrix. Okay. That information is contained completely inside in that matrix. So that is a local linear representation of a nonlinear system. Local. This will be valid only in the local neighborhood. Okay. Now, in order to proceed, we have to know how to solve differential equations, second order differential equations, linear ones. Probably you have all learnt that in your college. Can I assume or should I do? It might be better to do, I know. It might be better to do. The moment I say it might be better to do, yes,